Hi, this is Leah from OpenIntro. In this video, we will see how to carry out a ChiSquared goodness of fit test. A professor using an open source introductory statistics book predicts that 60% of the students will purchase a hard copy of the book, 25% will print it off on the web, and 15% will read it online. At the end of the semester, he asks the students to complete a survey where they indicate what format of the book they use. Of the 126 students, 71 said they bought a hard copy of the book, 30 said they printed it off on the web, and 25 said they read it online. Carry out an appropriate test to see whether there is sufficient evidence that the professor's predictions are incorrect. So in order to structure our response, we're going to use this I4C framework that stands for identify, choose, check, calculate, and conclude. So the first thing we want to do is identify our hypotheses, and we'll test those at the alpha is 5% significance level. The null claim, the thing that we're going to assume from the outset, is that the professor's predictions are accurate. That 60% would purchase, 25% would print, 15% online. The alternate claim, the thing that we're trying to see if we have enough evidence for, is that the professor's predictions are not accurate. Notice that H sub A doesn't say what those percents are. It just says that they're not what's stated in H sub O. Now we're ready to choose the appropriate test. We have one categorical variable, and we're looking to see if its distribution matches a hypothesized distribution from H sub L. We're going to do a chi-squared goodness of fit test. And now we need to check the conditions. The first one is we have one random sample of less than 10% of the population. Here we do not have a random sample, as the professor surveyed his students, so we'll have to treat that sample as if it were a random sample of a larger population of students, and note that our results will be impacted by that assumption. Next, we're interested in looking at the expected counts. We need all of them to be greater than or equal to 5. So we have to calculate them. So first, we can see that we have the observed numbers in each category. We have the expected percents based on H sub O. And so now we need the expected numbers based on H sub O. We have 126 students, and that's given, but we could have added up the three numbers, 71, 30, and 25 to get that. That gives us the total of 126. And since we expected 60% to be in the purchase group, we'll take 60% of the 126 to see how many we would have expected to be in the purchase group. And that'll give us 75.6. Expected numbers don't have to be integers. Observed numbers are integers, but expected numbers like averages don't need to be integers. To find the expected number for print, we'll take 25% of the 126, and that gives us 31.5. For the online, we'll take 15% of the 126, and that gives us 18.9. These are expected numbers or expected counts, and those are all greater than or equal to 5. So that condition is met. Now we're ready to calculate. We'll calculate the chi-squared statistic shown here. So there'll be three terms in our sum. The first one, we'll look at the observed number in the purchase group, that's 71, minus the expected number of 75.6, quantity squared, divided by the expected number of 75.6. Notice that when calculating chi-squared, we always use the observed and expected numbers, not the percents. So we'll do this for the next two groups as well. And that sum will give us our chi-squared statistic. The degrees of freedom is the number of categories minus one. Here we have three categories, purchase, print, and online. So our degrees of freedom will be 2. Okay, so now we can evaluate this chi-squared statistic. And we could do this manually, or we could do a calculator shortcut. So I'm going to pull up a TI here, and I'm going to go to Stat, Edit. So first thing we want to do is put the observed numbers, 71, 30, and 25 in L1, and put the expected numbers in L2. So observed numbers in L1, expected numbers in L2. Then we'll second quit to get out of here. And now we'll do the test, stat, tests. and find chi-squared goodness of fit test. Chi-squared GOF for goodness of fit. So we'll do the chi-squared GOF test. Our observed numbers are in L1, expected numbers in L2. The degrees of freedom is 2. And so we're ready to calculate. And we see that we get the chi-squared statistic. And immediately below that, we get the p-value. Okay, so we can record these values. To get these on a TI-83, you have to do some additional steps. So for instructions on doing this on an 83, you can visit that link tinyurl.com/chisqti-83. Okay, so before we draw our conclusion, let's comment on what we've calculated. We've calculated the chi-squared statistic, which is a measure of how much our observed counts deviate from what we would have expected if H sub O were true. So the larger the chi-squared statistic, the more our observes are deviating from what we would have expected if H sub O were true. The p-value is the area in the upper tail of the chi-squared. So the area under the chi-squared distribution with 2 degrees of freedom to the right of, in this case, 2.32. That p-value is large. And so because our p-value is large, it's greater than alpha, we don't reject H sub O. We don't have enough evidence for H sub A. So we do not have enough evidence that the professor's predictions are not accurate. Notice that this is not the same as saying that we have evidence for H sub O. We're not saying that we think that the percents are exactly 60%, 25%, 15%.